You can start.
Okay. So thank you to Thirumurugan and the organizing team. And obviously, since we are running a bit behind, I will try to keep to time as we discussed. In terms of the topic, it's a little different from what you've heard till now. It's a more acute or intensive care-based topic. And I'll be focusing mainly on the Euro consensus guidelines and sharing a few points from that with you. We'll start with a case. This is a term baby which I managed in my unit. Baby was born in another private hospital in Dubai. Normal birth weight, 39 weeks gestation, and the cesarean was done for failure to progress. The baby needed resuscitation at birth for poor respiratory effort. There was failure of the saturation to improve, and the baby was intubated and IPP was given. There was no diagnosis made at this time. The blood gas showed significant CO2 retention. The pH was 6.9 and PCO2 was in the hundreds. They did a chest X-ray, which showed this. And obviously, the topic of my talk gives you the diagnosis. So it's a congenital diaphragmatic hernia on the left. You can see the mediastinal shift. The entire heart is to the right. The baby is intubated. And this was after the baby was in NICU. So because this delivery hospital did not have pediatric surgery, they contacted my hospital. They spoke to me and the pediatric surgeon, and we decided to transfer the baby to our unit. Baby was paralyzed before they shifted and was on ventilation. The saturation was maintained well on 0.4, and we had already given them the advice not to give a high pressure and to accept slightly lower saturations. After we received the baby, we tried to wean the paralysis, but there was carbon dioxide worsening and the mediastinal shift on the X-ray worsened as well, so indicating that the gaseous distension was more with the swallowing. So we continued paralysis. Initially, the blood gases were maintained. We could wean the ventilation, but then the baby needed high frequency because of very high CO2 due to the above episode. We were able to switch back, and because the baby was stable and met the criteria for a stable baby, we decided to operate by day 3. There was no significant clinical pulmonary hypertension in this baby. And the finding was of a posterior defect in the left dome of diaphragm in the foramen of Buchtalek. The entire small intestinal content as well as the left lobe of liver was in the left pleural cavity. It was reduced back to the abdomen and primary closure was done. And as an active decision, we did not insert a drain as the baby was ventilating well intraoperatively. And this is the current guidance as well. The baby was on antibiotics, received TPN via long line, and was nil perural on free drainage. We maintained the paralysis for the first 24 hours post-op. We tried to minimize the duration of paralysis, so we weaned it off, and the sedation and analgesia were weaned off after 3 days. Baby was stable in the post-operative period ventilation-wise. We started trophic feeds on day 3 after the bowel opening. The baby had persistent gastric aspirates, and as we increased the feeds, we noted the abdominal wall was quite tense. It's possibly because the entire intestinal content was in the chest wall and the size of the abdominal cavity was small. I mean, it's not common to need a pouch for the reduction of the diaphragmatic hernia. This was a primary closure. However, over the next 2-3 days, as abdominal wall stretched, it started getting better and baby was extubated subsequently. Antibiotics were discontinued by day 7 post-op with the blood culture negative. The baby was weaned off NAPPV to CPAP and then high flow and came off all respiratory support by day 11 post-op. The baby progressed to full feeds by day 15 and the central line was removed. Cranial ultrasound was normal. Echo had shown PPHN but no structural heart disease. Baby established suck feeds and was discharged by day 18. We had 3 babies with diaphragmatic hernia in the past year and all of them followed a similar course. Thankfully, maybe luck factor was there that we didn't have any of the severe diaphragmatic hernias which would have needed a patch repair. And incidentally, all 3 were not diagnosed antenatally again. Antenatal diagnosis is taken as a poor prognostic indicator. The earlier it is diagnosed, the poorer the prognosis. The baby was reviewed regularly at follow-up. There was mild reflux, otherwise no concerns, normal neurodevelopment, and currently last saw at 2 years of age and is thriving. So the incidence is 1 in 2,500 live births approximately, and the left Buchtalek hernia is seen in 85%, while the anterior Morgagni hernia is in 10 to 15%. Mostly it's left-sided, and there is a very high risk of mortality. The bigger centers have started reporting 10 to 40%. 10 to 40% mortality rate. The best centers report as high as 90% survival. However, the size of the defect makes a difference to the survival rate. And there is a big shift in which part of the organs are involved. So it's mainly the pulmonary hypoplasia, and the cardiac function also plays a big role in how the baby settles down. If the disease is severe enough to need ECMO, there is more than 50% mortality, even in the best centers. And of course, ECMO is not widely available in many places. There is a variable degree of pulmonary hypoplasia depending on the severity of the defect. There is a decrease in cross-sectional area of the pulmonary vasculature and alteration of the surfactant system as well. Increased muscularization of the intrazenar pulmonary arteries is noted. In the very severe cases, left ventricular hypoplasia is observed as well, and this plays an important role in the management postoperatively, especially. The pulmonary capillary blood flow is reduced because of the small cross-sectional area of the pulmonary vascular bed, and the flow may be further decreased by abnormal pulmonary vasoconstriction. That is why more and more units are going for pulmonary vasodilators, a trial of nitric oxide, a trial of sildenafil if needed, and so on. The older concept was to operate early, as they thought the presence of the intestines in the abdomen, the lungs was in the chest, was going to hamper the lung expansion. However, we know that it's not the physical effect, it's a vascular effect, as well as the stability of both the pulmonary and the cardiac systems. So we now wait till the hemodynamic stability. I'll come to it later as to how we define it. And at least 24 to 48 hours after the resolution or improvement of pulmonary hypertension in those babies who have significant pulmonary hypertension. So I would refer you all to go through this consensus statement, which is the standardized postnatal management of infants with congenital diaphragmatic hernia in Europe. Most of the pointers are very valuable points, which people have adopted, and I would suggest that we go through them. So we have the recommendation starting from the prenatal management and delivery. It is very important that we have antenatal assessment of severity, and we can do that by measurement of the observed to expected lung to head ratio. If the lung to head ratio is below 0.5, it's a poor prognostic sign. Also, the position of the liver is important. If the liver is in the chest wall, you have a poor prognosis. In case of anticipated in the chest cavity, In case of anticipated birth prior to 34 weeks of gestation, steroids can be given. Delivery after gestational age of 39 weeks is preferred. And if you can manage it in a high volume tertiary center, it's better. After the delivery, the infant should be routinely intubated without bag and mask ventilation. This is an important step which we are all conversant. And as we know, the scaphoid abdomen that we look for, as well as the mediastinal shift, these are the two pointers if you don't have an antenatal diagnosis. The goal of treatment in the delivery room is to achieve acceptable preductal saturation between 80 and 95%. So you don't need to rush to achieve the 95%, and you follow the AAP protocol. However, you don't need to worry if it stays around 80% as long as the baby is stable. Ventilation should be done with the peak pressure as low as possible. You don't want to over-distend and damage the lungs, and preferably we shouldn't exceed 25 centimeters of water. An oro or nasogastric tube with continuous or intermittent suction should be placed, obviously, to decompress the stomach immediately. The blood pressure has to be maintained at the normal level for the gestation. So we don't need to go for suprasystemic blood pressures, even if there is pulmonary hypertension, as we will see later. In the case of hypotension or poor tissue perfusion, we can try the two boluses of normal saline, which we normally do. In case of persistent hypotension, even after the admission of saline, inotropic and vasopressor agents can be considered. In the babies who are predicted to have good lung development based on the scores we discussed earlier, we could even consider spontaneous breathing, as mechanical ventilation obviously is going to damage the lungs to some extent. However, this is probably not going to be followed by most units. Pre-medication could be considered before intubation if possible. However, neuromuscular blocking agent should be avoided during the initial treatment in the delivery room. Once you come to the NICU, as I said, if the distension and the swallowing is going to make your ventilation worse, you could paralyze the baby. And postoperatively, for a brief period, you could consider. So paralyze to the minimal extent needed. There is no role for surfactant as a preventive treatment in either term or preterm infants. You could individualize, but remember that surfactant could make things difficult by causing over distension as well. So in terms of ventilatory management, conventional ventilation is a preferred initial ventilation. However, you could use high frequency as rescue therapy if you have failure of conventional mechanical ventilation. we should use minimal ventilation as best as you can. So accept lower targets of saturation as well as PSCO2 can be higher. So our pre-ductal saturation 80 to 95%, post-ductal above 70% is adequate. The CO2 can be anywhere from 50 to 70 millimeter of mercury, so permissive hypercapnia. We prefer less than 25 centimeters with a PEEP of 3 to 5 centimeter and rate of 40 to 60. Reduce the FAO2 if the saturation is above 95%. So this is the main message. In the previous lecture, Professor Pejavar clearly explained minimizing intervention, and this is another example. Stick to basic physiology. As long as the baby is stable, don't flog, and you'll be fine. Infant should be sedated and monitored using validated tools, and preferably avoid paralysis if you can. If symptoms of poor perfusion or low blood pressure happen with a preductal saturation below 80%, we should consider echocardiography immediately to review the shunting, and your treatment can be based on that. If there is hypovolemia, you consider fluid therapy followed with administration of medication as guided by the echocardiography. And echocardiography should be performed within the first 24 hours, both to identify structural defects as well as to look for pulmonary hypertension. If there is pulmonary hypertension that is documented, inhaled nitric oxide, if you have the facility, should be administered for at least 1 hour. We start with 10 to 20 parts per million, and it should be given at least a 1 hour trial. And if the oxygenation index is about 20 or the upper and lower limb saturation difference is more than 10%. In non-responders, inhaled nitric oxide should be stopped because the outcome has been shown to be poorer in the babies who do not respond to nitric oxide where it is continued longer. The definition of responders is a decline of 10 to 20% in the pre-post-ductal difference or an increase in the PaO2 of 10 to 20%. The hemodynamic parameters like the blood pressure may increase, and the lactate might reduce as well, showing better hemodynamic stability. If a baby doesn't respond to nitric oxide, you could consider intravenous sildenafil. It has been recently available. Most centers may not have intravenous sildenafil, and because these babies are not fed, oral sildenafil is not an option. If there is suprasystemic pulmonary artery pressure and right to left shunting through the foramen ovale, IV prostaglandin could be considered. So we should also review the different medications that are used. So Mildenone could be considered as well in certain situations. And please remember that keeping the duct open might be favorable where the right heart seems to be getting an overload. So ECMO is given where you have inability to maintain the preductal saturation more than 85% or postductal saturation more than 70% despite your efforts to ventilate. The PaCO2 is worsening with a pH less than 7.15 despite optimization. You don't want to use very high pressure. So if the pressure has reached 28 centimeter of water or the MAP is more than 17, to maintain a saturation of 85%, then you need to consider ECMO as well. Obviously, you would have tried nitric oxide in these babies as well. If there is inadequate oxygen delivery with metabolic acidosis and elevated lactate more than 5 and pH less than 7.15 as well, so you're having perfusion failure as well. Systemic hypotension resistant to fluid and inotropic therapy and urine output dropping. So all these are basically factors which indicate that the baby is not coping hemodynamically. And if the OA is more than 40 for at least 3 hours. So ECMO availability is obviously one of the difficulties we face. And even with the best of centers, if you need ECMO, if the baby is sick enough to need ECMO, you have a high risk of mortality. So the surgical repair should be performed after we have clinically stabilized. And this is defined as a mean arterial blood pressure, which is normal for the gestation, preductal saturation of 85 to 95% on FAO2 below 50%, lactate is below 3 millimoles, urine output more than 1 ml per kg per hour. So it doesn't mean we need to wait 10 days. It just means you need to wait for the stabilization. And in our baby, we could achieve that fairly soon. And we were able to operate. And that may happen in different babies at different times. So you have to stabilize. Even if the baby needs ECMO preoperatively, you can perform the surgery while the patient is on ECMO. No routine chest tube placement is needed postoperatively. The fluid should be restricted on the first day, and we should increase intake subsequently. Diuretics could be considered to maintain the urine output. And once we have operated, preventing anti-reflex therapy should be done because the intestine has been in a different location and there is a significant risk of reflux in such babies. We had one baby with the right diaphragmatic hernia who had very severe reflux, and we had to do fund application for that baby at follow-up. And preoperatively, the patient should receive only parenteral nutrition, as these babies cannot be fed. So poor prognostic factors, we mentioned early antenatal diagnosis. If the stomach bubble is high up in the antenatal scans and you pick it up by 20 to 24 weeks, it's a poor prognostic sign, because invariably the pulmonary hypoplasia is going to be more severe. Prematurity, again, if it is associated, you have two problems to deal with. Growth-restricted babies, other associated major anomalies, especially cardiac anomalies, and presence of pneumothorax. Recently, they have graded the severity into A, B, C, D, depending on the size of the defect and whether they have cardiac associated anomalies or not. The size A is, I mean, the type A is similar to what we saw, where you can do a primary repair. Type B is where you need a minor patch repair, and type C and D are the more severe ones, which may need ECMO. So the need for a patch at repair, the need for a feeding gastrostomy, or need for oxygen at discharge are also taken as poor prognostic signs. So to conclude, diaphragmatic hernia is a serious life-threatening congenital anomaly. There have been significant changes in the approach to management. I would say in the past 30 years, there has been constant evolution of the management, from a very aggressive first day surgery to waiting and treating, and then managing the hemodynamic state, the pulmonary hypertension, as well as supporting the heart appropriately based on regular echocardiography. Surgical repair preferably is done in centers with expertise, and it's not an emergency repair, but repair after hemodynamic stabilization. The severity of the defect impacts the outcome, as we discussed. So thank you for listening, and thank you again for the opportunity. If we have any questions, I'm happy to address.